So I'd like to tell you about implementing some of these sorts of matrix algorithms in large parallel and distributed environments. And this could be of interest for a number of reasons. One of which, I mean, actually the MMDS meeting started in 2006 when we, there was a lot of interest on the theory side on the theory of matrix algorithms. And we got to know some numerical analysts, and the question is, are these sort of things useful in practice? And so I think it's fair to say that if you were ask people back in 2004 the state of the art, everyone on the theory side would say, wow, this is a wonderful theory and it's great. Everyone outside the theoretical computer science either probably never had heard of the methods, or if they had heard of the methods would say they're probably useless. So that was a little disconcerting. But it was clear that if you sort of understood what was going on under the hood, the algorithms were in fact very applicable, but there was a bit of a theory practice gap. So if you've, the key sort of structural idea that was necessary in order to have that happen was decoupling the randomness from the structural properties of the vector space, and the sort of simplest manifestation of that are these leverage scores you've been hearing about. And so if you fast forward the clock just a couple years, 3 or 4 years, blend and pick, originally an LSRN now that I'll talk about in a little bit, could basically beat Lapack on basically any tall dense matrix of size couple hundred by couple thousand. So I mean, that's actually a remarkable statement. Because it's one thing to have very sort of nice and elegant theory. It's another thing to have nice and elegant theory that's sort of plausibly or arguably useful. It's another thing to go head-to-head with something like Lapack, which is a high-quality software library of a bunch of algorithms on its own footing that's been optimized for decades, and do better than it on its own ground on basically any tall, dense matrix. And once you were able to do that in the regression context, you could have extensions to implementations of low-rank matrix approximations, a bunch of other things, a lot of data applications that you heard Petros talk about, and some novel sort of developments that respect sparsity that you just heard about. So that's very good. And it leaves open the question, though. The original motivation was to do this at very large-scale data applications. And so all of that was in RAM, basically. So the question is, can you really implement these things in large-scale parallel and distributed environments? And there the issues are very different in terms of communication versus computation and so on. And so the answer will be yes. I'll describe this. A lot of this is with Zhang-Ri Meng, who's probably here in the audience, and who'll have a poster later, so you can also talk to him about that. And what you'll see is interesting. It certainly is the case that when you go from small scale to large scale, typically easy things become hard. But occasionally, if you dust off your textbooks, hard things will become easy. So if you're interested in doing an optimization, who would use the ellipsoid method outside of theory? Right? Would you actually use that in practice? So we'll get back to that. So it's, the sort of high-level motivation is if you're at small scale or medium scale, data are oftentimes modeled by graphs and matrices, and so you hear a lot about that here, and you need to compute eigenvectors and correlations and so on, and that's relatively straightforward in RAM. Maybe you can come up with slightly faster methods. If you're really very, very large scale, it's much more common to model the data with flat tables and the relational model, in which case you're doing some sort of computings with joins and selection, other sort of counting measures that are much more traditional in databases, so for example in Hadoop. And so the question is, can we really bridge this gap and do what we'll call vector space analytics or vector space computations at very large scale? So if you think about that, it's not obvious that the answer is yes, that you can even do that, right? Exactly computing eigenvectors and correlations is expensive, requires lots of dot products, this and that, and so on, lots of communication. But on the other hand, the answer is not obviously no. I mean, one lesson from all this work on random sampling algorithms and random projections, as you just heard, really are just random sampling in a randomly rotated basis where the leverage scores are uniform. So, you can get with an epsilon, and very reasonable epsilon, using very small samples, matrix of a million or a couple million SNPs, I'm not sure the exact number Petros had up, you can do, with an epsilon of that with, 100 different SNPs. So you can get pretty close. So, the question is, can you do that? So the answer will be yes. And to talk about that, I want to talk about regression problems. So I'm going to talk about a couple regression problems, but I'll call them LP regression problems. You have a matrix A, it's going to be tall. We can handle other cases, but for today, let's talk about tall matrix. A right-hand side vector B and a norm. So I'll call it a P norm. And so the two norm will be an example. The one norm will be the other norm. And so say M is much larger than N, many more constraints than variables, so it's tall. And the goal is given some epsilon, could be epsilon is equal to 0.1, could be 10 to the minus 10, whatever. You want to find a 1 plus epsilon approximate solution to X hat and relative scale. So namely, if you plug the X back in, you want to be within 1 plus epsilon of the optimum. And in some cases, you want to say that those two vectors are pretty close also. You can, the short answer is you can get that in L2, and it's trickier in other cases. So in particular, P equals 2 is the least squares approximation problem. P equals 1 will be the least absolute deviations problem. I mean, a very natural thing, but you use much, much less because it involves solving a linear program, not sort of vector space computation like QR or the SVD. These will be the two special cases we'll be interested in. So why very rectangular data? So there's a lot of data sets that are rectangular. You might have thousands of SNPs, thousands of people by millions of SNPs, a bunch of other examples. And so there will be sort of direct applications of this. Another reason you might be interested in very rectangular data is that very overconstrained L1 and L2 regression really are a very good model for implementing other sort of vector space analytic computations at very large scale. L2 basically involves QR and eigenvectors and things that are bread and butter for a lot of matrix completion methods. L1 is going to involve an optimization, and so how do you deal with optimization in these sorts of settings? But you know, at least as importantly, if you think about the history of probably matrix algorithms more general, but certainly these randomized matrix algorithms, I mean, really the best advances for the low-rank problems came by considering the underlying regression problem. So back in 2004, people considered the low-rank problem. They applied the randomization very coarsely. So under the hood with these randomized methods using something called the Johnson-Lindenstrauss lemma. That holds for general metric spaces. Euclidean spaces are just much more structured objects. And if you take a very powerful hammer and hit a Euclidean space, so that you're going to do damage if you're not careful. And so, you know, if you consider the very rectangular problem, you can start to decouple the structure from the randomness and some other things. And once you make advances there, you get the advances in the low-rank matrix approximation with CUR or other things. So that was true in theory, and that was also true in terms of implementations in RAM. So we're considering this here. So for L2 regression, least squares approximation, you probably know there's direct methods, QRS, VD, normal equations, and so on. You know, high precision implemented in Lapack, but it can be hard to take advantage of sparsity and hard to implement in parallel environments. You can also use iterative methods, and you should think of conjugate gradients, although we'll come back to an interesting variant of that. But iterative methods, the pros are, you know, low cost per iteration. It's typically easy to implement in parallel environments. You just need to do a matrix vector product. You can compute approximate solutions, you know, at various levels of approximation epsilon. Typically, it's hard to predict the number of iterations because it's going to depend on something called the condition number, which we'll get back to. L1 regression, linear program, you know, you might use interior point methods or simplex. You know, who would use the ellipsoid? We'll get back to that. And a bunch of other sort of methods. So a lot of algorithms for low rank problems, continuous optimization, and so on, I mean, boil down to these sorts of things. And so these are good models for implementing vector space analytics more generally. So why randomized algorithms? A lot of traditional algorithms are not particularly well suited for problems that are really very large. I mean, Petrus was talking about 10,000 people by a couple million SNPs, and that's large by some standards and not large by other standards. Distributed in parallel environments, communication's a bottleneck, data has to be accessed via passes. So a lot of very large scale distributed in parallel type settings. So randomized matrix algorithms really, you know, are faster, you have better worst case theory, and that's one of the important insights in the last 5 or 10 years, that randomness really can be a valuable resource to get better worst case theory if you're interested in theory. Simpler and easier to implement. So there's a lot of work done in numerical linear algebra and in continuous optimization where you're really worrying about pivot rule decisions, very sort of fine detail, which make an enormous amount of difference in practice in some cases. If you take a step back, I mean, that can be difficult to implement if you're really interested in the downstream application. And so how do you implement it? It turns out randomness sort of smooths and denoises a little bit. So a lot of the algorithms, it turns out, are just much easier to implement. You can parallelize them and make them more scalable. So big success story in scientific computing applications. The blend and pick I mentioned, the low-rank matrix approximation, a lot of that stuff's motivated by scientific computing problems where the matrix is implicitly represented as an operator. Big success of these sorts of ideas, but you know, structured in a very different way than a lot of the large-scale analytics. So can they really be implemented in these sort of large parallel and distributed environments? So parallel and distributed means different things to different people, and I'm not going to go into a lot of the details, but just to give you an example of what we're thinking, you might have some sort of shared memory, it might be a little bit larger, in which case you have to have MPI or some message passing type interface. You get larger, you might want to be doing MapReduce. I don't want to make claims that MapReduce is the right or the wrong way to do it, but as a matter of sort of just empirical fact, it's sort of the de facto standard for a lot of the very large scale analytics. It has sort of a restrictive interface, and so one of the questions is how can you do richer sorts of computations like we're interested here, and so we'll be talking about an MPI implementation and MapReduce implementation. So two important notions that you need to sort of high level points, and they instantiate themselves in different ways depending on whether you're interested in the worst case theory or high precision implementations in RAM or parallel and distributed settings will be the following. First is something called statistical leverage. You should think eigenvectors. The second is going to be something called condition number. You should think eigenvalues. If you want a low precision answer, what you need to do is identify the leverage structure of the data. If you want a low precision answer, epsilon is 0.1. If you want to iterate that to a high precision answer, you need to find the condition number properties of the data. So I'll mention what these are in L2. There's going to be extensions to L1 that I'm just going to gloss over, but there's analogs there. It's a bit noisier and messier than in the L2 case because it's not as structured. But you need to identify these two different things. So the statistical leverage scores of a tall matrix A are the diagonal elements of the projection matrix under the column span. Equivalently, they're equal to UU transpose, where U are the left singular vector. So they're the things you heard about before. They measure how well correlated the singular vectors are with the canonical basis. You know, which constraints have the largest influence on the least squares? The notion of coherence and outlierness. If you know about matrix coherence and you're in an area that parameterizes problems in terms of matrix coherence, what you saw from Petrus' talk is that the coherence is not at all small or uniform typically. Coherence is the largest leverage score, effectively. And computing them is exactly as hard as solving the least squares problem. One thing Petrus did not emphasize is that, in fact, you can compute them faster than the naive algorithm, but you can compute them in basically high dimension times low dimension log low dimension time. Condition number, you should think eigenvalues. If you have a quadratic well, it has to do with the aspect ratio of that well. It's the maximum singular value over the minimum singular value, and it's related to the number of iterations you need to take. And again, computing this is generally as hard as solving the problem. So these are two good ways to think about what's going on, but they don't immediately lead to good implementation. So here's a meta-algorithm. Using the L2 statistical leverage scores, as Petrus described, construct an importance sampling distribution. So you're tall. Generalizations of this will hold when both dimensions are high and you're low rank. But, you know, identify the relevant non-uniformity structure for spectral, for Frobenius, for nuclear norm. I mean, all of these hold. Randomly sample a small number of constraints according to that importance distribution. Solve the subproblem. If you do that, you get a coarse solution. I say coarse because the running time is mn squared over epsilon. So it takes as much time as solving the problem, if you do it naively. And, you know, if you want epsilon to be 10 to the minus 10, that's going to be a problem. So a naive version of this does not do so well, but this meta-algorithm can run faster in RAM. If, say, you do a Hadamard-based random projection, and then you sample uniformly in the rotated space. Hadamard-based random projections, or not Hadamard-based, will rotate you to a random basis where the leverage scores are approximately uniform. Sample uniformly over there. That's what random projection algorithms do in matrix contexts. It might be buried in the analysis, but that's what they do. Or quickly compute approximations to the leverage scores. As David mentioned, given a tall matrix, you can compute very fine 1 plus epsilon approximations to all of the leverage scores in faster than n times d squared time. And you can make this meta-algorithm high precision. Basically, you take this coarse solution, which you construct with sampling or projection, and you use that as a preconditioner to iterate. And there's a couple different ways to do that, but that's the rough idea. All right. So say we want to solve L2 regression problems, and say we want to solve L1 progression problems. We're going to use the same meta-algorithm, but it'll be implemented differently. So for L2, let's choose some over sampling factor. If we're n by d, we're going to sample, 2n. M by n, we're going to be sampling 2n columns. Generate a random Gaussian matrix. We're not going to do a Hadamard thing. I'll get back to why that is in a second, but a Gaussian matrix. Do some computations on the low rank problem. You get a preconditioner. This is basically R inverse of QR, but I've written it in terms of SVD. You use this thing that you constructed from the low dimensional projection as a preconditioner, and you solve this problem. Iterate to solution. So you can do this in RAM, or you can do this in a distributed parallel environment. So we're using a Gaussian here. It has the best theoretical guarantees on conditioning. That's going to be important in a minute. It can be generated very fast. The naive way doesn't do it, but non-trivial ways do it. Use a level 3 blast on dense matrices, so we're able to map cleanly to there. We'll speed up automatically on sparse matrices and fast operators, and works. We need an extra all-reduce operation, but works when A is partitioned along its larger direction. So although it's slow in terms of flops, in a lot of these settings, communication is more expensive than flops, and it's going to have a better communication profile. It has a better communication profile, one, because you can implement it parallel directly, and then it's going to have a better communication profile for a less obvious reason when you do the iterations. So you get the exact answer. The interesting thing is that the distribution of the spectrum of A times N, the projection, doesn't depend on A. It just depends on the spectrum of a certain Gaussian matrix. And so here's the expression you get if you plug all the numbers in. If you choose 2N columns, your condition number is 6. If you choose 3n, it's 4. If you choose 1.5n, it's 10 or whatever. So it's 6, constant. All right? So that's a very strong result, and it's constant. So we'll see why that's useful. So we have implementations of this in shared memory, C++, MATLAB interface. You have a non-trivial implementation of the random number generator. That's actually the most expensive thing if you're not very careful. Message passing interface with Python. Single-threaded blast for matrix-matrix multiplications and matrix vector products. Multi-threaded blast Lapack for the SVD. And you can use a conjugate gradient-based methods to do the iteration, but that's relatively expensive because it's going to require lots of dot products. So you can use something called Chebyshev semi-iterative method, and we'll get back to why that's the case. In terms of solving real-world problems, it's sort of marginally slower than blend and pick if you just work with tall, dense matrices, but it's faster on a bunch of other things. You lose rank, you're a little bit larger, you have sparsity, and so on. So on a bunch of algorithms designed to illustrate where LAPACK or MATLAB blend and pick perform well, don't perform well, LSRN, and the fact that these are numbers rather than something large means it ran in some reasonable time. So that does well in RAM. What if you're going to implement it not in RAM? So you can use conjugate gradient to iterate. So LSQR is a conjugate gradient method. It requires 2 matrix vector multiplications per iteration and 2 cluster-wide synchronizations. Basically, these variants of conjugate gradient require the computation of lots of dot products, and that's going to be expensive. But if I promise you that the condition numbers are good, then you can go back to your templates for solutions for linear equations. You can go back to Golub and Vinlon, and there's something called the Chebyshev semi-iterative method, which uses Chebyshev polynomials. All right? That will perform better if I promise you that the condition numbers are good, better in the sense that it will require less communication. So in particular, here's a Python snippet for this code. What we can use the Chebyshev semi-iterative method, the cost per iteration will be the same two matrix vector multiplications, that's fine, but one cluster-wide synchronization. So basically, we're able to take the fact that we have a fast parallel pre-processing at the front end, and it's Gaussians. Gaussians are much, much smoother than Hadamards, and we guarantee you that the condition number is 6. And so we're able to use a Chebyshev semi-iterative method that will work when the condition number is very good, which it rarely is in scientific computing problems, which is why you don't use Chebyshev, you use conjugate gradient-based methods. And then at the second step, when we do the iteration, we can do an iterative method that'll be faster. So the interesting thing here is you can do LSRN with or without conjugate gradients. This is out in the wild. This is out on Amazon's EC2. We have it with 8, 16, 32, 64 processors. Number of iterations is actually worse. But the time for iterations is going to be much better, and that has to do with those communication properties. So we're able to do the randomized pre-processing at the front end, get a coarse solution very quickly, in this case with Gaussian projections in a distributed environment. In a lot of cases, that's all you want. The computation of the leverage scores boils down to least squares approximation problem. If you need a factor of 2 on that, stop at the first step. If you want 8 digits of precision, iterate. And if you're going to iterate, you can do it the hard way with conjugate gradient that requires more dot products and more communication. Or because we've guaranteed strong concentration on the singular values, we can use Chebyshev's semi-iterative method. So that's a neat example where you really have to take the randomness and map onto basically the computational architecture. So that's good, actually. And so the question is, can you use similar ideas in L1? Because L1 is known to be more robust to outliers, but on the other hand, it's also known that it's more expensive. So at a high level, we're going to see the same sort of thing. We need to get a good coarse solution. We need to iterate to a fine solution. Problem with L1 is that orthogonal bases, remember the U from SVD or Q from QR, which define the leverage scores effectively, there's not an obvious notion of a nice basis there, so we're going to have to define something. And the iterative method is going to be a little bit different because we're doing a convex optimization and not just a vector space computation where we iterate to the minimum of a quadratic well. So I'm going to be talking about L1. You're going to see a bunch of equations that I'm going to gloss over, but they're going to be of the form of a one norm of A times X. So without loss of generality, you can write the one norm problem this way. So I haven't assumed that B is 0 or cheated or anything like that. The A matrix here basically includes information from the right hand. Basically, it's the A matrix augmented with B. In the L2 problem, you don't need to use information from the right hand side. The L1 problem is less structured, so you use information from the right hand side. So we'll be using this form. And let's say you have a matrix, call it U by analogy with the L2 case, and we're going to say it's alpha, beta, P well conditioned. The point is it's well conditioned. If the norm of U is sort of small, and U doesn't stretch or shrink vectors by too much. So in the L2 case, that's an orthogonal matrix, right? You have an N by D orthogonal matrix where D is small. The Frobenius norm is the low dimension, basically, the square root of the low dimension. And it's a rotation, so it doesn't stretch things by much. Define the analog of this to be here if you have an alpha and a beta that are small, where by small I mean low-degree polynomial in the low dimension. And this will be D or D squared, N or N squared. Let's define the L1 leverage scores to be the L1 norms, or the L1 norm squared, of the rows of a one-condition basis. So these are not well-defined in the sense that we're not going to be rotationally invariant, but they're going to be well-defined up to low-degree poly-N factors. For what I'll be talking about today, let's gloss over that. There's actually some interesting questions that we can be marginally worse by one metric and marginally better by an iteration metric. So let me gloss over that today. But these are only going to be well-defined up to low-dimensional factor, which means you might need a few more iterations. And let's define the L1 norm condition number this way. Don't worry about what this means, except it's sort of the obvious extension of the L2 norm condition number. There's less structure here than the L2 case, but we're going to define this. All right. Same meta algorithm. Using an L1 well-conditioned basis, construct important sampling distribution for the L1 scores, define the coarse non-uniformity structure, randomly sample a small number of constraints to solve a subproblem, do random sampling with that non-uniformity structure, solve the subproblem. So in the same way as you saw a naive version of this didn't do so well in the L2 case, a naive version of this we showed a couple years ago does even worse. It's mn to the fifth over epsilon squared times. So that's a real ugh. So that's certainly not going to work. But as with L2 regression, you can make this algorithm much faster in RAM by approximating the L1 leverage scores quickly, by performing what I'll call an L1 projection. I'll say what I mean by that, to uniformize them approximately, so sort of an L1 notion of projection. And it turns out we can make this algorithm work in higher precision in RAM or in distributed environments. So the basic idea is the sort of thing that David was describing. You need to define a probability distribution that depends on what I'll call the L1 leverage scores. If you take your tall matrix A, don't worry about all these various factors, but you know, if you sample with a probability distribution that depends on that non-uniformity structure, then you're going to preserve the subspace. And so this, I mean, I can gloss over this because David went through some detail. This is basically saying you're preserving a subspace. You can, in fact, do slightly better if you don't preserve the subspace, but let me not gloss over that. But you basically need to reproduce this sort of result also. If you do that, and you let x hat be the optimal solution to the subsampled problem, then with high probability, you're going to have be within 1 plus epsilon, so exactly the metric you want, the relative error approximation. All right? So there's a couple ways to do this. We can do this with an oblivious projection, an L1 analog of a Gaussian or whatever, or we can do this with some sort of, you know, rounding or conditioning or something, and we'll see how you can do it both ways. So let's say we want to find an oblivious, by which I mean independent of the data projection matrix, pi, such that, you know, something like the Johnson-Lindenstrass case in the L2, you don't stretch or shrink the various vectors by too much. So things are a little bit worse here, but a times x in the one norm is less than pi times a times x, that's easy with scaling, the hard part's the other side, is less than, let's call it kappa, and you want kappa to be small. So you compute pi times a, and you do a QR on pi times a. So analogously to the L2, it'll turn out the projection matrix will be different, but analogously to the L2, if you do that, then a times r inverse is L1 well conditioned. So in a sense, this is a good basis for L1. So how do you construct pi? So we had the M end of the fifth algorithm, and we shelved that. And then Sol and Woodruff last year showed that using basically a matrix of Cauchy random variables, so think of a projection matrix as a bunch of Gaussian random variables. If you do something much like that, except you use Cauchy random variables, in time MN squared times log N, you can get a condition number here that's going to be N log N. We can have a fast version of Cauchy where, in a sense, you string together a bunch of Johnson-Lindenstrass type projections and then do some Cauchy projections. You're a bit faster, the condition number is a bit worse. And so you're going to see those trade-offs there, and we'll see other examples of that later. So how does this perform, right? There's a lot of big O's and polynomial factors and things like that. So just to give you an example, say we're doing Cauchy, the fast Cauchy performs similarly. Say you're doing a Gaussian projection, no conditioning, just sampling based on rows and something uniform. And so this is a, you know, a mediumly scaled problem. What's the size? So this is 10 to the 10 by 15, so very rectangular. Small numbers are good because we're measuring a 1, 2, and an infinity norm on a couple different data sets that we looked at to illustrate the strengths and weaknesses of the method. And what we're plotting here is the first, so we generate 100 or 1,000 samples. What we're plotting here is the first and third quartile. Down is good, and so you see you get 0.08 to 1115 with the Cauchys. Gaussians are a little bit worse. In general, if you don't do this preprocessing, you do very poor. So if you don't do conditioning, you do something uniform, the numbers are just going to be much larger. And you can easily, you know, random data or something trivial like that, everything's going to perform sort of similarly, but it's very easy to construct examples where these sorts of things fail rather egregiously, and you saw the SNP data. That's not at all uncommon. That's typical. Here's a plot that shows the same sort of thing. You know, blue is the Cauchy and green is the Gaussians. The interesting thing about the Cauchy and the Gaussians is that the Gaussians, you get slightly better results, but the conditioning number depends on the high dimension. But if the low dimension, you're cubing it or something, you need to get pretty rectangular for the high dimension to be really high. If you're slightly less rectangular than this previous case, the Gaussians actually will perform pretty well in general. You can construct examples where they don't, but as a general rule, they'll perform pretty well. The Cauchys tend to be a little bit more finicky, but they'll perform well across the board. So say you want to do an L1 preconditioning. So you might want to look at the data, something analogous to QR, where you look at the data and you do some pivoting or something. You want to find an ellipsoid where the ellipsoid sort of, if you shrink it a little bit and you stretch it a little bit, it sits around the L1 norm ball of the data. And if you do that, you basically have a good conditioning. So by good, you know you can use a Lonergan ellipsoid. This thing exists. The condition number is square root of the low dimension. Pretty good, actually. Not 1 plus epsilon. That's pretty good, actually. If the low dimension's 100, you're talking 10. That's not bad for a condition number. If the low dimension's 1,000, you're talking 30. That's not bad for a condition number. Clarkson in L1 regression paper in expensive time, mn to the fifth, will get kappa with n. Needs multiple passes. The point is, if you want to do it in a distributed environment, you should think of a pass as like a map-reduced iteration. You'd like this to be single. And with Zhang-Rimeng, we have a bunch of results where the time gets better and better, the conditioning gets a little bit worse and worse, and there's going to be a natural trade-off here. If you want to implement these things, this is going to be a good result because it's reasonably quick, the condition number is not too bad, and we can do it in a single pass. So fast ellipsoid algorithm, you have a tall matrix, so you're going to cut it up along the high-dimensional axis. You'll do a couple fast Johnson-Lindenstrass-type projections along each piece. You'll paste the stuff back together. And you can use this to get a one-pass conditioning algorithm, meaning basically in one pass over the data, you can get a well-conditioned basis, you know, this thing that we need that defines the coarse non-uniformity structure. So you can implement this in RAM, or you can implement this wherever you want. If you want to implement this in MapReduce, which I'll show you the results in a second, what you want to do is input a matrix A and a kappa such that you're pretty well conditioned. Don't worry about the fact that I have a 2 here. Pretend it's a 1, but don't worry about it affects the condition number slightly. Input a matrix A and a condition number. So if we can do the condition number in one pass, now we have a well-conditioned basis, and we know what the condition number is. So we input that to this algorithm. And we need to implement the random sampling, which means flip a coin for each column or flip a coin for each row or do something like that. So the way it instantiate here in this sort of distributed setting is for each row A, let P be a probability that's basically the leverage score, the L1 leverage score of that row divided by the sort of condition number. The N squared is just a normalize in a sense. So divide, you know, but it's the L1 leverage score of A. For K, emit a key value pair with some probability. Otherwise, don't. So you're emitting a key value pair to map to the MapReduce framework. At the reducer, you collect these rows associated with the key, assemble the matrix A, constructed from the bunch of values, and you compute the answer to the small subproblem. So it's the same thing, construct a small subproblem, except you're mapping to the map reduce type framework, and you solve the small subproblem on one machine with whatever you like, say anterior point methods, and return this answer. In particular, computation is relatively expensive. Communication is the expensive thing here. So doing 100 matrix vector products is hardly more expensive than doing one. So we're going to be able to compute multiple subsampled solutions in a single pass. So you want to iteratively solve the high precision. You can use subgradient. That's going to take some huge number of passes. You can do a gradient. That's going to take some large number of passes. Ellipsoid. It turns out you can use the method of inscribed ellipsoids. So this is the ellipsoid method for doing, you know, optimization. The extra work per pass is a lot. This is a result from a while ago, but the computation here is relatively inexpensive, and we want to minimize the number of passes. So we'll just eat that. I mean, think of that as low dimension cubed. It's slightly more than that. So the method of inscribed ellipsoids is like a bisection method, except it's in higher dimensions. We're using this because it gives us the smallest number of iterations, which you saw there. Extra computation, but that's basically free. We can initialize using subsampled solutions. The problem with a lot of the vector space analytics is that you need to iterate. So if at all possible, we'd like to avoid that. And you can do multiple queries per iteration. So the point is that we need to construct a function, we need to construct a gradient, and we can do that in parallel in the sense that if you're on a 10-node Hadoop cluster for a matrix of this size, you know, 100 gigabytes, say, similar numbers large we have now, you can do a single query in 282 seconds, you can do 100 queries in 320 seconds. So marginally more expensive to do 100 queries. That computation's free, which is why we're using this method that we had to dust the textbook off of. This is a million by 20. If you construct the initial guess with a bunch of subsampled solutions. Never mind iterations, you know, moderate to low precision. Y-axis is a log scale, 10 to the minus 6, 4, 2, 10 to the 0, 10 to the 1. So log scale. And you do that good initial guess by doing multiple things in parallel in the MapReduce framework. What you get is something that's 3 or 4 orders of magnitude better than just the naive initial guess. You iterate, these get better, but it's sort of slow. You iterate, these get better. The two lines are whether you're doing 1 or 100 queries at each iteration. But you're, with no queries, you're starting off from a much better initial guess because of that, and you can iterate similar results, although we haven't gotten all 4 plots, if you're at size 15 by 10 to the 10, roughly. So this is, I think, 0.5 terabyte or something. So you're really doing these sort of analytics at basically terabyte scale. So these are the first examples of non-trivial implementations of randomized algorithms at something that's approaching tera and petabyte scale. Implementations of the randomized algorithms includes least square approximation and least absolute deviations, these two very ubiquitous problems in special cases. How does this work? There's a big theory practice gap here. Maybe I will have given you a little bit of that flavor. But we're able to take advantage of the fact that the randomized algorithms, in some sense, really are inherently communication avoiding. You can use the same meta algorithm in theory or in RAM. Here we've done it in parallel and distributed settings, and we're able to take advantage of the communicating avoiding nature of it and look beyond the flops. And really, in a sense, we're designing these algorithms that are using more computation than the traditional algorithms, but have much better communication profiles. And we're able to do that by mapping to the architecture in very non-trivial ways. You're doing, you know, matrix optimization with conjugate gradients. That's going to be expensive. If you have very strong control over the condition numbers, which you can do in the very first pass, you can use Chebyshev's semi-iterative method. I mean, not obvious, right? But it turns out to be the case. And the same sort of thing in MapReduce. We're not using simplex or anterior point, we're using an ellipsoid-based method. We're using the method of inscribed ellipsoids with multiple initial queries to construct a very good search region and then take advantage of the fact that computation is going to be relatively free there. So with that, let me wrap up, and thank you for your attention.